discussion time, possibly fight time. So I was curious, so how many people in here have a CS degree or something like a CS degree, software engineering, something like that? So half-ish? You guys are like half raising your hands. Do you only got 2 years? What's that?
The miners count?
Yeah, that counts. That's actually a really interesting case. So it's about half-ish. So I was just curious, you know, while we're programmers for a while, a lot of us have been programmers for a while, various experiences. Like, I was curious, is a CS degree actually useful? What do we do? Like, how much does that help you? How much do you use what you learned in your computer science classes in real life?
This one time, I used it. But the other, 9 years I've been working at it.
So you feel like it was worth it?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I was going to say, speaking of someone who started programming when he started the CS programmer, been using a lot of the stuff.
Yeah.
I was taught. But my teacher was really good, so.
What are the kind of things that you learned that you felt like were applicable?
I learned on how to make a regex engine kind of thing. And then I learned all the basic stuff through school as well. Proper syntax and white space and style.
Yeah.
I don't have a CS degree. I have a marketing degree, which does nothing for me. So I would say, I don't know what I don't know, but I think maybe I'm missing some like he's talking about, some basic technology foundation that a lot of others maybe do have, because I came in and right into Rails basically, and then kind of had to dive in going the other way instead of starting at the foundation and going out.
So you feel like maybe you're missing out. That's something I was curious about. How about
you? I was going to say, I think I have kind of an interesting jumping off point from that was I went and got my degree halfway through my career.
Oh, okay.
So I came off a successful project with me and all that stuff. And I was like, I'm going to go back to school. But I didn't really want to go back to my job. But what I realized in meeting the teams before was I was missing, I kept on running into algorithm analysis or just basic structure stuff, or I mean it was fine for I'd say 90% of my job, but as soon as you started getting into something that was really difficult, you just hit a wall where the stuff that talked the base level knowledge just was gone. I don't know the words you're saying anymore. So going back it was and only getting a minor, I never got anything from professional development stuff, which I always felt was really, really behind in school. What I did get was all that base theory stuff that no one was even going to teach you in the professional world. So discrete mathematics, data structures, algorithm analysis, that stuff I still find come majorly in handy, especially when you look at some weird caching algorithm or something, looking at something that's really not very performant and going, oh, well, that's what you're doing. It just helps you pick it apart where before I've been like, it works, cool, sweet.
Yeah, I would probably kind of bounce off that and say my experience being the same is that basics and whatnot. It's not necessarily that you're going to use it every day, but sometimes it kind of informs what you're doing. So we actually had one of those kind of happening moments recently. We built a smart list or a smart feature where it was our users could set a bunch of conditions and decide whether or not their employees fit inside of a certain group. And we realized when somebody did it that you could theoretically set a bunch of these until they caused an infinite loop and brought our app to the ground. So at first I was like, well, it was one of our testers that caught it. It was never in production. They killed our sandbox server. And I thought, okay, whatever, I'm going to ignore this because in college they told me that when you are faced with deadlock prevention, you should ignore it. which worked for a couple months. And then somebody said it'd be really nice if we could get this fixed. And actually it was one of our interns that forced me to actually think about it. And as I thought about it, I realized, we built a graph and we're detecting cycles. This is discrete math. I know this. And by the end of the day, we had it fixed and now you can't crash our app. So I mean, you may go a few years before you need it, but then the time comes, you're like, oh yeah, I remember, I learned that 10 years ago. I'm going to use it now.
So it seems like the low level, or the consensus is that it's actually, it is pretty handy. So, anybody disagree with that?
I don't know that I disagree with it, but I will say, coming from the perspective of somebody that
you're giving a presentation next time.
But the one thing I can say is not having that structured background, I feel gives me a little, as I'm learning, gives me a little more liberty to ask dumb questions without worrying about somebody saying, shouldn't you have learned this like your sophomore year? It's an interpersonal thing. Your mileage will vary depending on what your personality is, what your management training environment is like, but at least that's how it's panned out for me. It's been kind of liberating to just be like, I don't know what anything you just said means. And
that's
they're
really
cool with that.
Yeah.
You were going to say something? I'd say from just a pure ring perspective, the foundation of, you know, just even just object-oriented programming would help anyone come up to speed with Ruby real quick, or any language for that matter. That being said, once you get into Rails or the web, you have HTML, CSS, JavaScript, some form of database probably, and from my experience from seeing other new hires fresh out of college with a CS degree, that doesn't help them that much as far as a website goes. But Ruby as a language, it helps a lot though.
Okay. Well, you next, then you. Or, no, you talk too much. You.
I went to school like a couple like community colleges, smaller colleges, and you know, did like visual basic stuff. I just wasn't really into computers, but I knew I kind of like wanted to get into this stuff, and this was back like 10 years ago, and you know, doing all that, it was like, well, this is crap. Programming is stupid. You know, I don't want to do this. But as time went on, you know, and I was curious, you know, and just do stuff with Unix and Linux, stuff like that. And it was like, oh, okay. Well, it looks like, you know, you really can do all kinds of cool stuff with, like, you know, some Perl scripts or just shell scripts and stuff like this. And I got interested in it on my own again, and kind of had to suppress, you know, all that stuff that the preconception I had about programming and what it really was. It's like, oh no, there's all this other stuff going on, like, you know, looking at Ruby and stuff like that, and that's kind of what sort of got me curious about it again. It's like, oh, I could like possibly make a tool that would help me do this thing at work that's been so annoying that I can't, you know, figure out a way to solve. So that's just it's another thing I could run out.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. I've worked with a lot of computational scientists, which, even though half of the thing is computational, they're not CS people. They're PhDs in biology or chemistry or what have you. So they learn how to program first, and then when they bring a machine to its knees because they've asked too much of it, then they go looking for a computer scientist to help them. So there was for a while in my career that I thought, you know, being a pure CS person might not be the way to go. That really you'd want to learn some discipline that uses computer science. Just like people use a calculator. Programming is a way to solve problems. So maybe you should learn that discipline before you learn computer science, or you learn just enough computer science to be dangerous. But then I've encountered a lot of computational scientists that need a lot of help. I've seen some disciplined programmers that came out of CS degrees. I haven't seen a lot of disciplined programmers that came out of something else. It's like sort of learn that discipline maybe through the degree, or maybe years of experience can make up for that too. You shoot yourself in the foot enough, you learn not to, but, or at least you learn a lot of ways not to, not all of them. But yeah, so it's, I don't know, it's interesting because I've seen really good developers that had no background in computer science whatsoever, but they were geniuses, and it's like, I have to solve this problem, so I'm gonna learn just enough.
Yeah, I was kind of hoping fast forward would be here, because several of them don't have CS degrees. I was hoping I could get Eli fired up, but...
yeah, you probably could.
Call him up.
So, right.
Yeah, you're on Skype. Phone. Go.
So, just
where I'm coming from. Going into college, I knew I wanted to learn to program because I really hadn't done much programming going into college. So I took, I mean, I was a CS major, supposedly. I took some CS classes, some twice. And then ultimately just decided college wasn't for me at the time. And then, so then I taught myself to program. So I guess my perspective is, for the stuff that I do on a daily basis, typically, like, I'm just a web developer, essentially, and typically for fairly low traffic sites, just get that out there, too. I don't feel most of the time that I'm missing much, and then I go to Fort Behavior, and, like, you guys are talking back and forth about some crazy scaling stuff you're doing and whatnot. And I'm just like my eyes glaze over, and I don't know what's going on. I'm gonna look at cats on Reddit. So like, there are definitely, like, I've often contemplated, like, I could probably afford to go back to school, and I'm pretty sure now I have the discipline to get the CS degree. But you know, there's also a part of me that's like, yeah, but I'm making good money now, and maybe I don't need it, but maybe I do.
That leads into my next question, because it seems like, you know, people are pretty pro in the idea. How often do people here read books that are, you know, pretty much pure CS, or close to pure CS, like a book about algorithms or something like that? How, like, you,
yeah, all the time.
All the time?
Yeah. Literally, I have one on my nightstand all the time. That's really geeky.
No, that's awesome. How many people want to hear read one at least once a year? Once
like
every
like college.
How many people have read one?
Like SICP or something?
I mean, that's like, you know, on the extreme end.
Like Introduction to Algorithms.
Design Patterns.
Like a design pattern book, you know, a book on refactoring. Like just, you know, something that's, you know, not necessarily like, we're going to teach you how to use this technology, but just like, this is an idea on how you might be able to solve problems at a computational level better.
Probably should.
I see hands back there.
Yeah,
you guys do?
Yeah, pretty much same thing. One on my nightstand. There's no better sleeping book.
That's
it's
actually,
amazing.
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
High praise.
Thrilling, but good God! Like after a while, it's like, okay, I'm full. This is all I can do. I mean, it's great. It's good to learn, but
and because of that, every time you pick it up again, you just automatically go back 2 pages.
Yeah,
right.
There are a lot of good free classes, like Stanford and MIT have free classes that, if you've got some spare time, if you want to watch a video or listen to a podcast, you can pick up a lot of stuff. And you don't have to pay anything as long as you have the kind of wherewithal to listen to it, kind of think about it.
I'm just curious because, you know, there's a lot of free, I feel like there's a lot of free pure computer science resources. Does anybody ever look at those videos? Like, has anybody gone through Stanford or?
Yeah, the classic, what was it, SICP? Or,
yeah.
You know, those videos are awesome.
Yeah,
they are awesome in so many levels.
You want to have a good time, you can go to the Khan Academy. They've got a lot of good, like, math stuff. If you're like, I haven't done math lately, let's do this.
That's
I did it for like 4 hours the other night.
It's always depressing to me, because I'm like, man, 8 years ago, like, I would have been like, this is easy. And now I'm like, what is this? Can we just do long division?
I think the hard part is figuring out what's going to be valuable to you and when you're just spinning the wheels, you know.
Yeah.
I question whether, you know, like, you're talking about that, going back to school, whether you'd be better off figuring out the exact resources that would be the best use of your time, you know, based on the types of projects you're doing right now or want to do in the future, whether you could set up, you know, your own education schedule better than what you did in school on a structured program.
That's sort of what I was maybe hinting at. I was wondering.
Well,
I'm
sorry.
We'll go with Steve first.
All right, so, one thing, we some of the guys from Rose, there's a few of us here, went to Rose Holman, but we've kind of had this discussion, is Rose Holman worth it? And it's kind of the one thing that we have always kind of gone back to is one of the best things we found there was just the people that were there, a bunch of people who are driven and had similar interests and could help point you in the right direction of finding something that's either interesting or useful or something along those lines. I think to that extent, I think the formal program can help you find that similar thing, but it's not necessarily just the program itself, I guess. And then I think the other thing is I started going back to work on my master's degree, and I found most of the classes were, a lot of them really weren't all that useful, just because, I mean, some of the classes were honestly outdated, which is kind of sad to see. One of the really good ones was actually data mining, because it's kind of generally applicable to about anything you're going to be doing. Going back and trying to analyze all that information, and the professor there was actually really good, but like the programming language class was just not all that useful. You see, I think the professor at one point said you can't have a language that's both object-oriented and functional at the same time. It's impossible. It's like, what about name every modern language now? Yeah. So.
So, kind of springboarding off that a little bit, like a lot of the people that I see that are kind of at the either heavily involved with or kind of at the forefront of like the big data revolution seem to have very, very strong CS fundamentals at play, like the people who are doing stream processing at Twitter and things like that. A lot of the stuff that I see them produce is very heavily like, you know, cap theorem discussion and, you know, computational theory type stuff. So I think it somewhat depends on where you kind of fall on the spectrum. Like, you know, to your point, Miles, like at this point, you know, web development, consulting, web development and Ruby is probably fairly mainstream, even if the adoption curve doesn't necessarily look like it. But, you know, as you kind of get on the newer trends, like concurrent programming, you know, multi-core stuff probably is going to bring a lot more of those fundamentals back into play. And, you know, it might be that in 10 years, once that becomes a little more mainstream, then it's less important to actually know that stuff. Again, because all the tooling has developed to kind of abstract away the really hard pieces of it. But right now, that seems like where it matters the most is when you're kind of on that forefront.
That's an interesting observation.
I think it's one of those things, you know, I'm arguing, I guess, for CS, and I wish I had it, but at the same time, it's, I mean, basically what I'm saying is I wish I knew more. I wish my knowledge base was more. But I think either way, the more important part is that you need to be motivated, you need to actually like programming and want to build stuff. And after that point, you have to be committed to keep learning no matter what you're going to call your time. So it's not like if you had that CS degree, that's all you need to know. You need to, like, every day, you need to keep learning new stuff.
I definitely agree with that. I think, you know, I was assuming that everyone here learns new stuff all the time, but
I'm just here for the drinking.
Well, that's entirely, that explains a lot. But if, you know, I guess I was curious if, you know, probably some things are more useful to know than others, and there's probably some vague ordering of, you know, learning, you know, some Ruby gem versus learning, of, you know, algorithm analysis of a certain kind. Were you going to say something, Joe?
I'm
out of steam.
I was just going to say, I think another interesting correlation between non-CS versus CS degrees would be what they would tell someone who's just starting out, like, where do I start? I think that the answers might be a little bit different from somebody that has a structured background versus a non-structured background. Like, I would tell somebody to start with math and algorithms, and somebody just starting that didn't have a CS degree would probably say, pick up a Ruby book. I just think you need to get your foundation down before you start to learn.
You got to find out if they're for real. You know, SICP first.
Yeah.
That's the first thing you do.
Yeah.
And then if you still talk to me after that.
That's funny. That I told a kid at work, he goes, I want to program it. I go, I'm going to buy a Ruby book. I go, no, just check out MIT, SICP online. He goes, I got to page one. And I stopped.
Solid effort.
Get your Ruby book.
So. I don't want to keep everybody here forever. This is a really interesting discussion. Hopefully we can talk more about it while we're drinking. Cool.